Macmillan Audio presents Tides of the Titans by Thoraiya Dyer. Read for you by Christine Marshall. Prologue. The monsoon threatens. Leaper grins at the sky, gripping the rope with a gloved hand behind his harness to control his descent. He shouldn't be headed this way. In a past life, and in this one, he's vowed never to go down, never to look back. He shouldn't be headed anywhere, yet it's his only chance to get his hands on Aurealis' sword. The mossy, ridged bark of the 100-pace-wide sweetfruit pine is fish-scale gray. It breaks away in brittle flakes with every brush of Leaper's sandal soles. Irak's teeth! Dangerous to go down when it's raining. Dangerous to go down when it's dry. If the bark's not soggy and peeling, the pieces of it, falling through 700 human heights, are possibly giving him away to all sorts of people, high and low, when he'd much prefer the element of surprise, thank you very much. When I climb back up, he thinks, as he lets the rope out a little more, I'll choose a different tree. Perhaps the neighboring spiny plum. Its brownish bark is hairy as tree bears, but better than this one. Faint raindrops fleck his bare arms and face as he drops faster, faster again. There's no point looking down. There's no light down there to see by, only the captured lightning that Leaper brings himself. It's more than a month since Odell's bodyguard Aurealis fell from this tree, deliberately, to her death. Leaper couldn't escape the scrutiny of his master Irak, the lightning god, until now. With 16 monsoons behind him, he's reached his full growth. Although the god has sent him on occasional political missions outside of Irak land, Irak's favorite furtive emissary has been harshly disciplined since a certain incident at Ulelin's temple. The rules have changed, and Leaper resents now having to ask permission to leave the emergent. So this time, he didn't bother to ask. Let them discipline him again. He needs the sword, Aurealis' sword, the one she was holding and possessed by when she threw herself down. Orin, goddess of beasts and birds, had intended the weapon to drink deeply of innocent blood. Aurealis had foiled that purpose. Leaper races the rain. He'll have to search for the body in the black soil below before the floodwaters wash it away. Since he's going all the way to Floor, he can't rely on his usual trick, once he's ready to return, of using a heavy, hacked-off wooden counterweight to take him back up to the forest canopy in a hurry. A stolen pocket clock, wound tight at daybreak, lies in the carry sack on his back to help him keep track of time in the pitch-black sameness he expects to find. He must keep track of time to make sure he doesn't lose the magical aura that allows him to pass freely through the gods-ordained and gods-maintained invisible barrier between canopy and understory. There's no magic barrier between understory and floor. Florian hostility and the potential to be swept away by floods are the only true barriers there. Leaper's lantern lies in the sack, too, separated from the clock by chimera cloth to keep them from interfering with one another. Leaper made the magical, trapped lightning lantern and its twin in secret. Yes, it gives light, they all give light, and some of them transport messages, and some of them kill. But the pair made by Leaper transport all kinds of small, non-living objects from one to the other. Leaper has used them for all his best thefts. Let the servants of the lightning god search him upon his return. Let them suspect him. Let them shake out his bags. His grin widens just thinking about it. Then the sky rumbles and the storm rolls in, and although he can't sense his master's terrible power below the barrier, he stops grinning. The monsoon has arrived. Just a few more hours. That's all he needs. I hope that's all I need. Purple clouds turn to purple specks, hidden by silhouetted black, thrashing leaves and branches. Purple specks turn to distant pinpricks of light. Leaper has reached understory. He has no fear of the infamously barbarous understorian warriors. If he didn't already know they superstitiously avoided the emergence of goddesses and gods, he'd still feel safe. Not only was he born an understorian, but in understory, anyone but a fool hides safely away in their tree trunk hollow at the first indication of the monsoon. Leaper reaches a level 1,000 paces down. His feet don't touch the ground. Odell's emergent is ludicrously tall, the rope strong and long enough. The knots tell him he's reached 1,200 paces. Sweat beads on his body. There's no wind, only oppressive heat. 1,400 paces. He can't feel the raindrops anymore, but individual drops aren't the danger. Once the rain really gets started, the rivers running down the sides of the great trees will rage, turning 100 winding ground snakes of water nosing blindly towards the sea into a single forest-wide flood. The sword will be lost. When he's at home in Irak's temple, Leaper loathes being reminded of what he truly is. Not the high-class child of Canopy, reflected by his carefully cultivated accent, but an understorian abomination. King's blood mixed with slave's blood, and his magical talent watered down by it. In the earliest days of his apprenticeship, he failed often, but now he borrows the power of old god's bones to make himself strong, and Floor is where the old god's bones can be found. His rump hits something hard. He swears, finds his feet, and rubs his bruised tailbone while rope coils tangle around his knees. Floor. Irak's teeth. When he gets the lantern out of his sack and unshutters it, blue-white light bounces from the buttress roots of the great tree, but shows little else. The neighboring spiny plum, 600 paces away, is a faint shape far to his left. Everything beneath his feet is black, feels sticky, and smells rotten. Leaper kicks at the mulch and jumps back at the horror of uncovered worms, white salamanders, and wriggling millipedes. Pieces of fallen bark begin brushing his shoulders. He's the one whose descent disturbed them, yet he came down faster than they did. Now the pieces are catching up, making a mosaic of green and gray against the black. Raising the lantern, he watches them fall for a moment. A pair of eyes gleam at the edge of the great tree trunk. No, it's only a flutter of falling bark. The sound of a footfall is his imagination. If Florian's had seen his light, they'd be putting spears through him at this very moment. They don't tolerate intruders, Leaper has heard, but they, too, must moor their floating villages in preparation for the monsoon. Leaper unwraps the pocket clock and checks it. The hand has only passed one of the 12 markers, but he knows it runs slightly faster in the first hours than it does in the later ones. He stows it away, begins sweeping the area, lantern in hand. There are footprints, but he can't read them. Areas of disturbed dirt and pine needles, but no body, no clothes, no sword. Orlon, he mutters angrily. Where are your god's cursed bones? They are not to be found, a woman's voice says behind him, and you ought not to look for them, lest you lose your hair for transgressing. By that, of course, I mean lose your life. Leaper whirls. 2 paces away, a slender arm whips up to shield dark eyes from the blinding brightness of the lantern. The owner of the voice is shorter than anyone Leaper has ever met, with white streaks in her straight black hair. Her brown skin is speckled with mud and sap patterns, which are intricate and must have been time-consuming. Her arms are smooth and left bare of the patterns, but sag in the muscles, giving her age. She seems to be alone. A woven string of dragonfly wings hangs, skirt-like but concealing nothing, from her hips. She wears no other clothes. For a moment, Leaper is speechless, and he's never speechless. In 7 years spent navigating the great city of Canopy, he's used many sets of cells to camouflage himself within the classes of people that surround him, recalling images of branching trees to help him slip into their inhabitants' vocabulary and mannerisms from the roots upward. A tallowwood represents to him the simple brusqueness of the hunter of Ganak, its branches ending in ritual rhymes where grunts won't suffice, while a floodgum is the formalized secrecy of the temple. The firewheel tree helps him to assume the smooth obsequiousness of court. He has no class association, no pattern of behavior to help him here. She doesn't look like any goddess, queen, farmer, or slave he's ever seen. I am called Leaper. He holds his empty hand out in surrender. What are you called? Utesh, she says, motioning imperatively for him to lower the lantern. She carries a small carving of a crocodile. Not a spear. A carving. Leaper narrows the lantern shutter to a more tolerable width, looking to her face for approval. Men must not meet the eyes of women, she says, unsmiling, not even the eyes of a linker like me. No exceptions for ignorant outsiders, if they want to keep their hair. Leaper stares at her bare feet, slathered in mud to the knees. Arlon was my... He begins boldly, hesitating over the lie that she was his mother. His skin is not dark enough for that. He remembers that much about her. My friend... Why shouldn't I look for her? She deserves the proper ceremony. In the corner of his eye, he sees Utesh tilt her head in consideration. We will give her the proper ceremony. She was one of us. We will celebrate her soul in the winged, warded way. Our ceremony has nothing to do with her body. That is pollution now, and washed into the crocodile spine in any case. Pollution? Leaper clamps his lips over the question. What about the sword she carried? Is that pollution, too? Certainly. The woman waves her carved crocodile in some general direction over her shoulder. Strong pollution. Our boats now avoid the west bank of the spine where it meets the hanging leaf. We already had need to avoid the east bank, since the speech splinters came to rest there at the end of the last monsoon, and all bones of the old gods are to be avoided. Leaper licks suddenly dry lips. He should have suspected the Florians beneath Odelland would have different traditions to the Florians beneath Irakland. The Florians from Gui, who had freely traded old God's bones with him, yet threatened to kill him on sight if he ever came down to them, might have taken Orlon's sword if they had seen it. These ones would not. They wouldn't come near it to touch it. Nor would they move human bodies. If only I'd come to Flor right away, both sword and body would still be lying where they landed. Too late. The crocodile spine is the name of the main artery of Flor flowing water. If Orlon's body and weapons are in it, he'll never find them. This journey is wasted, he realizes aloud. The journey for the sword is, anyway. What had she said about speech splinters? Thank you for not killing me. Wasted, Utesh answers with apparent surprise. Did you not understand me? Arlon lived with you in the trees for the greater part of her life. You should eat her flesh and speak for her at the boat building. Eat her flesh? But you said... Her eyes narrow at him, and he remembers to lower his gaze. And he'd thought the absence of a spear in the woman's hand was comforting. You said her body was pollution, but you're going to eat it? He should leave. She can't stop him from leaving. She's a woman alone without understorian spines for climbing. Utesh sighs. She steps forward, holding out the crocodile carving. My words are not perfect, she says. The flesh you will eat is the flesh of honeykiss fruit. We suspected that any who loved Orlon would anticipate the preparations to release her soul and come to the cutting place. Instead, you blundered about here. The Great Mother was wise to send me to wait for you as close to the pollution as I dared go. She shakes her head. I was chosen late to be a linker. As I told you, we of the Crocodile Rider clans do not use the speech splinters that the sorcerers and their slaves use. Our previous linker was killed. Unfortunately, I am proof that old women do not learn languages as easily as young men. But I try my best. She waggles the carving. Take this, for protection. Do not touch my hand. Do not touch any women or look into their eyes when we reach the village. Otherwise I'll lose my hair. Understood? Leaper takes the carving. He grips it tight. Utesh, the crocodile rider, turns to lead him into the dark. He should leave her and climb back into canopy. The sword isn't here. But what about the so-called speech splinters? The thought of their potential tantalizes him. And he's being welcomed to a Florian death ritual. What Canopian has ever had that?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.